So I think we should start now. Our first talk article is smoking in pregnancy. It's from, I have taken it from 2019. I have not shared the talk articles in the group because of the copyright issue. And there are the, you can take screenshots. I have made the major summary points here in the slides. Please mute yourself. There is some disturbance. You want to ask, unmute yourself, otherwise keep muting yourself. Thank you. Okay, so smoking in pregnancy. First of all, we should know why we are reading this topic. Why is it important? Because it has got some effects in pregnancy. Effects are miscarriage, stillbirth, placental abruption, preterm birth, and low birth weight. Okay. First of the two points are about the death of the baby, either in the form of miscarriage, which is before 24 weeks of gestation, or after 24 weeks of gestation, it is stillbirth. Then a well-known side complication of smoking is placental abruption, preterm birth, and low birth weight baby. You can remember preterm birth and low birth weight baby usually come together, because if a baby is born preterm, obviously her birth will be less than the average. And placental abruption, as you know, is the important cause of smoking is the important cause of the placental abruption. So we have four major effects in pregnancy: miscarriage, stillbirth, and placental abruption, and preterm birth, and low birth weight. And accordingly, the problems associated with preterm birth and low birth weight, these are the recognized effects in pregnancy. And now we are coming to long-term effects. These were the immediate effects or short-term effects in pregnancy. Now the long-term effects. Remember, most effects of the smoking comes on the brain. Okay, so such as impaired neurological development, endocrine dysfunction, oncogenesis. These are the three effect neurological. These are three long-term effects. It affects on brain. It affects on endocrine system, all the glands, and it can cause carcinogenesis, oncogenesis. Three effects. And what happens in neonate? When a baby is born, there is an increased risk of sudden infant death syndrome. We have discussed it in earlier in our session. Attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, poor academic performance in school, and future smoking in adulthood. So most of the factors are associated with the neurological system. The second point, most of the factors, sudden infant, attention deficit disorder, poor academic performance, these are all the cognitive problems associated with the neurological system. And the further smoking in adulthood is the most late effect. Now, who is going to tell me short-term effects? Short-term effects of smoking.
Miscarriage, stillbirth, placental abruption, preterm birth, and low birth weight.
Excellent. And now, who is going to tell me the long-term effects of neonatal smoking in neonate?
Long-term effects.
What are the three categories?
Oncogenesis.
Yes. Yes.
And in infant, there is a risk of sudden infant death, risk of attention-seeking behavior.
Attention deficit disorder.
Attention deficit disorders. And risk of adult smoking,
poor academic performance,
in
adulthood.
Poor academic
performance.
So what three systems are affected in neonatal life? One is neurological,
endocrine,
yes,
and oncogenesis.
Oncogenesis. Yes, excellent. So now we are going to read a little bit about pathophysiology. In the talk article, pathophysiology is given in very detail. You do not need to do very details, but you should know the important points. So in cigarette smoke, there are almost 4,000 compounds. And we are going to discuss three main compounds in according to this talk article. One is carbon monoxide, the other is tar, and the nicotine. First of all, we are going to discuss the carbon monoxide. Carbon monoxide, what does carbon monoxide do? It binds to hemoglobin and make carboxyhemoglobin. Left shift hemoglobin curve can be due to air pollution. What does it mean? So if a patient is exposed to air pollution, it can give the same laboratory investigations like she is cigarette smoking. In a patient who does not smoke, the carboxyhemoglobin level is only 1%. In smokers, the carboxyhemoglobin level is 4%. But in heavy smokers, the carboxyhemoglobin level is 15%. 1%, 4%, and 15%. And what does carboxyhemoglobin carbon monoxide do? It does FGR and preterm birth, which we have read in the effects of pregnancy. They are due to the carbon monoxide, fetal growth restriction, and preterm birth, basically due to hypoxia. Okay, so what does carbon monoxide do?
It binds with the hemoglobin and causes left shifting of the hemoglobin carbon.
Okay, and in what other condition you can get the same picture?
Pollution.
Air pollution, excellent. And what is the normal level of carboxyhemoglobin in our body?
1%.
And it's in
smoker, it is 4%, and heavy smoker, it is 15%.
Excellent. And what is the effect of carbon monoxide on the fetus?
It causes fetal growth retardation
and low heart rate.
And preterm birth. Okay, excellent. So what does NICE recommend? NICE recommends, previously NICE only, yes, Paras, excellent. Previously NICE only recommends that a woman, when presents in labor, ask about the her smoking status, whether she smokes or she does not smoke. But now the new recommendation is that all women should be screened for exhaled carbon monoxide at booking by to disclose non-disclosing smokers. Some women are there and they do not tell you that they are smoking, or they have just quitted the smoking. Okay, so you cannot judge by any means. So what do you do? You will do her test, exhaled carbon monoxide at the booking, and it is usually done by a midwife or any healthcare professional. You have to tell the patient beforehand that you are going to perform this test on her. So what is the benefit of this test? First benefit is that if someone is lying and you can disclose. And the other is, if someone has stopped the smoking sometimes before, it is very encouraging for her when she comes to know that carbon monoxide has been cleared from her body. So now remember this, this could come in MCQ because it's a clinical question, exhaled carbon monoxide testing at booking. What are the indications? Now, what are the indications? Referral to NHS Stop Smoking Service. This is a very, very famous service, NHS Stop Smoking Service. And you have to tell every patient who is smoking about this service. So a woman with high exhaled carbon monoxide level, if it comes more than 4, who deny smoking, then you have to refer her to smoking service. And the women who say, I am smoking, then obviously you have to refer her to smoking service. Occasional smokers and smokers who have quit the smoking in the previous 2 weeks. Most of the women, there's a high rate of women who quit smoking in pregnancy, but there is a chance of relapse. So you have to refer them to smoking stop smoking service. So the next component we are going to discuss is tar. First was carbon monoxide, now the tar. What is tar? Actually forms a residue on the skin. You have noticed a residue sometimes, people who are heavy smokers, their residue in the skin and the mucous membranes, and this same blackish residue on the lungs of the smokers. This is due to tar. And tar is actually a compound, again have many components. So tar produce compounds that are teratogenic and heavy metals. Heavy metals like cadmium, which accumulates in placenta. So teratogenic, as we have discussed in neonatal life, they can cause oncogenesis, and in what does it has in effect? It in fetus, immediate effect, it causes growth restriction, the same as in the carbon monoxide. Okay, so tar and carbon monoxide has the same effects on fetus growth restriction, but in carbon monoxide there was an additional effect of preterm labor. The third and important component is the nicotine. So nicotine is basically the addictive component. because of which the patients cannot stop from tobacco taking. Addictive alkaloid derived from tobacco and is a potent stimulant of parasympathetic nervous system. It readily crosses the placenta. What are the fetal effects? Nicotine basically affects the neurological system. We have discussed that most of the effects are on the neurological system. So it is a neurotoxic and causes neurological and all behavioral problems, which we have discussed, attention deficit disorder, and poor academic performances. These are all due to nicotine. So what are the three important components of the cigarette smoke?
Carbon monoxide, tar, and nicotine.
So and where does nicotine affect? Which system is affected by nicotine?
Neurological system.
Neurological.
And what are the effects of carbon monoxide and tar?
Causes residue on skin, mucous membrane, and lungs.
Yes, and which of the three causes carcinogenesis? Nicotine, carbon monoxide, or tar?
Carbon monoxide.
Carbon monoxide.
Carcinogenesis.
Carbon oncogenesis.
Tar. It is tar. Remember here, tar.
Ma'am, nicotine slide. Can you show us?
Nicotine slide.
Thank you.
Okay. So these are the only little points you need to remember in the pathophysiology. So our important main focus is how to help women to stop smoking in pregnancy. Cessation rates are much higher in pregnancy, as we have discussed it earlier. So what are the factors which are associated with spontaneous cessation? Which women are at more, will be more help, can help more in reducing or stopping the smoking? Living in a household with a non-smoker partner, smoking few cigarettes per day, a previously successful quit attempt, more awareness of the negative consequences of the smoking. The D point is up to us. We will give her awareness about the negative consequences of the smoking. So these points you can take opposite, that which women are at more risk of not stopping, in which the women's partner is a smoker, who are heavy smokers and who has previously unsuccessful quit attempt. So their morale will be down, that it cannot be stopped by them. So remember these four points which are associated with spontaneous cessation. Postpartum relapse. So there is a high postpartum relapse. In pregnancy, women stop for the sake of the baby. But after pregnancy, most of the time, a third of the spontaneous quitter in pregnancy only remain abstinent for 1 year. The other two-thirds will again start smoking. And what are the women in which there are high relapse rate? Either they are single women, they are parents women, have a partner or a household member who smokes, with high depression scores, as we already know, depression is associated with smoking. Those with a heavier smoking habit, pre-pregnancy, breastfeedings are less likely to prolapse. Sorry, prolapse, no, it's relapse. Relapse. Okay. So, high relapse rate, again, remember, there are five high relapse rate factors: single women, parents women, have a partner or household smoker who smokes, the high depression rates, and those with a heavier smoking pre-habit, pre-pregnancy, and breastfeeding is a protective against relapse because it also reduces the depression in women. So these now we are going to discuss the strategies of smoking prevention. What we are going to do the preventive smoking. There are actually two basic strategies which we can use in pregnancy: psychological intervention, and other is the nicotine replacement therapy. There are also electronic cigarettes which are being used in non-pregnant women, but till now data is not available for pregnancy. They are in trial and being tried and been having good results. But we have two documented interventions. One is psychological and the other is nicotine replacement therapy. And we are going to discuss in them one by one. What is psychological intervention? It includes in the form of counseling, feedback, provision of incentives. We can even give incentives. See? Feedback interventions, measurements of tobacco use, such as salivary or urinary nicotine or exhaled carbon monoxide. As we have already discussed, if the patient exhaled carbon monoxide test comes as very less, then it will be very encouraging for the woman, and he may stop and continue to stop smoking in pregnancy. Nicotine. And there are some other methods of checking the nicotine. We can check in saliva and we can check in urine. These are the feedback interventions. We will tell patients that they have stopped smoking and there are the results, and it will help them. Take a brief look on it. These 5 A's for brief smoking cessation intervention. First is ask about smoking. Identify and then document tobacco status of every woman. Okay, and ask about previous quit attempts, because if she has a previously unsuccessful quit attempt, then most likely she's not going to quit again. Then after ask, for example, if I ask a patient, do you smoke? In part 3, you will notice that this is a must question in every history. It has got one mark. Do you smoke? And if she says yes, then your other point will be, have you ever thought about quitting it? Okay. And then you will advise that there is a very good service of NHS Stop Smoking Service, and I will recommend you to that service. So first ask and then advise to quit. And if after giving advice, check if whether she is willing to quit or not. On a scale of 0 to 10, you ask, how ready are you to quit? Ask the patient. If she says, I am ready to, on a scale of 1 or 10, she says 2 or 3, then there's a very less chance. You have to give her more help. But if she says 8, 9 or 10, then she's a good patient, and she will soon quit smoking. And you need not to worry much about it, but you have to assess it. Now you have asked her, then advise her, then assess her. Then if you want to quit smoking, you need to assist her. For the women willing to make a quit attempt, refer to in-house smoking cessation service or local NHS Stop Smoking Service. What is in-house smoking cessation? In a hospital, there could be, if there is a smoking cessation service, you will first refer her to there. Otherwise, there are NHS Stop Smoking Services, you will refer there. Discuss methods of cessation, including counseling and the use of nicotine replacement therapy. Arrange. After assisting, you will arrange a follow-up contact, usually a week after the quit date. If the woman has quit, congratulate them and encourage them. Okay? And discuss about her whole course or pathway, how she overcome this problem, what obstacles were there, what problems were there. And for those who are still smoking, who has not quit, revisit the 5 A's and encourage to set a new quit date. So there are 5 points: ask, advise, assess, assist, arrange. Now, who is going to tell me what are the 5 A's?
I
only name. Yes, Leela.
Ask. Yes. Assist.
Excellent.
Advise. Arrange.
Assist.
Assist, and then arrange.
Arrange at the end, very nice. Now, who is going to tell me what do you ask in first ask? What do you ask from patient?
We will ask, do you smoke?
Okay, if she says yes, then what the next question? Excellent, Paras.
The next question will be, do you have ever thought of quitting the smoking?
Okay, yes. Answer is yes.
Then we will ask her to count on the scale that how much she is willing to quit smoking from 0 to 10.
Excellent. And after that?
After that, we will refer her to either inpatient hospital service or ask advice, assess, and then we will assess her to NHS stop smoking sedation service or assist her.
Yes. First a local hospital service, then NHS stop smoking. If local hospital service is not available, then we will advise to stop NHS stop smoking service. Okay. And then you have advised her, you have given her appointment from that smoking service. Then
when did after you call that, we will arrange her follow-up.
Excellent. When? After how many time?
I don't remember exactly.
1 week. 1 week. Okay?
Okay.
1 week. Usually a week after the quit date. Okay? See here. Or usually a week after the quit date. Okay. So if the woman has quit the smoking, then what will you do? If the woman has quit the smoking, hello?
Yes, we will congratulate and encourage her, yes.
Yes, and if she has not quit the smoking, then?
Again start
from A's. Ask, advise, assist. Okay, so the 5 A's you need to remember. Now, this is a trans-theoretical model of intentional behavior change. Ask, advise, assist. Excellent, Zegam, Paras, excellent. So I forgot, Zegam, are you Sahrish?
No.
Neelam,
sorry, I forgot. Okay, Neelam. So now this is the trans-theoretical model of intentional behavior change. Look at the first point, pre-contemplation, no intention of changing behavior. Women does not want to change her behavior. Then you will take her to contemplation. How? You will aware her about a problem exists. Aware a problem exists, but with no commitment to action. Then preparation, intent on taking action to address the problem. Okay, and then if she agrees, then we will go for action, active modification of behavior. Once you have modified on behavior, then you will advise her on maintenance, sustained change, new behavior replaces old. Relapse, fall back into old pattern of behavior, then you will again start of the pre-contemplation behavior. Pre-contemplation, contemplation, preparation, action, maintenance, relapse. You should at least remember the names of the trans-theoretical model of intentional behavior change. So we have discussed psychological therapy, and now we are going to discuss the nicotine replacement therapy. Okay, so in psychological therapy, we have discussed we can do counseling, feedback sessions, and we can even give incentives. But in nicotine replacement therapy, what is nicotine replacement therapy? Basically, we have discussed the three components. There are 4,000 components. We have discussed only three. The last one was the nicotine. Okay. So in nicotine replacement therapy, what do we do? We only give nicotine. So it does not have any other hazards of smoking, of tar, of carbon monoxide, and other minor compounds. In non-pregnant state, there is a 50 to 60% cessation rate with the help of nicotine replacement therapy. We do not have exact figures in the pregnancy. What are the routes of NRT? Routes are, we can give mucosal or by transdermal routes. Transdermal route, it is the slowest route. What is it means? Slowest means it very slowly release the nicotine. Lozenges, it can be in the form of chewing gums, oral suppressants. These are all mucosal routes, micro tabs, inhalers. Okay, the only transdermal route is transdermal patches. So what are the adverse effects? Usually the adverse effects are irritation. Where a patch is applied or spray is being done, there could be some irritation and there could be headache. Accelerated metabolism results in low nicotine levels. NRT with behavioral support can improve cessation rates in pregnancy, but with no effect on postpartum cessation. Please remember this. It only helps in the antenatal period, not on the postpartum period, because patients are usually highly motivated. And we are giving nicotine to prevent her, basically to meet her addiction. We have discussed nicotine is the basic compound because of which women need to take it. But this nicotine is less in amount, slowly released. So it does not give that much satisfaction. That's why there's a high rate of postpartum cessation. Now, who is going to tell me in which forms nicotine replacement therapy can be given?
Mucosal or transdermal.
Okay, and what is the slowest route?
Transdermal.
Transdermal route, excellent. And in which period it affects more, antenatal or postnatal period?
Antenatal.
Antenatal period. Okay, excellent. So, here we go. So, so now are the electronic cigarettes. Now nicotine replacement therapy is clear. Basically, the purpose of nicotine replacement therapy is only to give her the addictive compound by which without which patient cannot quit smoking. Now the electronic cigarettes we have discussed, these are battery powered elements, a solution of water, propylene, glycol or gasoline, nicotine and flavoring. Basically in electronic cigarettes, again, the main compound is the nicotine and the flavorings. So what does it cause? It causes rapid rise of nicotine. We have discussed in NRT, NRT causes slow rise of nicotine, but electronic cigarettes causes rapid rise of nicotine. It does not contain tobacco, tar and carbon monoxide. So you have noticed or must have, actually it is in, I have seen it in many movies, when due to staining, because you know tar does the staining of the teeth. Due to staining, they use electronic cigarettes so that there is no stain. And besides, it does not have other compounds. It is noteworthy that electronic cigarettes are the most common smoking cessation aid used in the UK today. But there is a lack of safety and efficacy data in pregnancy. So, in pregnancy, it can be used, but with cautions, and it is not advisable to use. If a woman is a heavy smoker, it cannot be controlled with the nicotine patch and psychological therapy, then we can proceed to electronic cigarettes. So this was all about smoking in pregnancy. Do you have any questions up till now in smoking in pregnancy?
No. Ma'am, I want to see a slide before PPH relapse. Postpartum relapse. Before that slide.
Postpartum relapse. Okay, just a minute.
I think I have missed some.
So this was all about smoking cessation during pregnancy.